Welcome to the Birds and the Bees podcast. This is Braxton Dutson.
That's the key. People aren't talking about it.
Everybody needs to know that porn is not a documentary.
It's not like if we don't talk to kids about sex and sexuality, they're not going to hear about it. They're just not going to hear about it from us.
They have tons of questions. They just don't know how to ask them.
All you have to do is be one chapter ahead. You don't have to know everything. Just one chapter ahead of wherever your child is.
Hey, everybody, this is Braxton Dutson, and I am the host of Birds and Bees podcast. I'm a certified sex therapist in Salt Lake City, Utah, and I am excited to have you here today because we are going over a topic that is frequently spoken about and rarely explored, which is the topic of STIs and STDs, sexually transmitted diseases and sexually transmitted infections. I have Jenelle Marie Pierce with me today. She is the founder of the STD Project, which is an online platform that teaches everybody anything they need to know about being tested, STDs, living life if you are diagnosed with an STD or an STI, and empowering individuals to still live the life that they want to live with if they have an STD or being able to get that taken care of. She's all about supporting those individuals and supporting all of us in understanding this world. So I'm excited to have her on today. We are going to be taking this in two episodes. One, the first episode is going to be all for parents talking to kids about sexual health. We are also going to cover what is an STD. We're going to cover what is an STI. And we're going to be able to explore a little bit about the stigma that's around it. We also talk about being, how STIs are passed, things that that parents need to be able to talk to their kids about. More than just don't get an STI, and by the way, of not doing that, that's through no sex at all. Kids need more information than just that, and so we want to empower parents to be able to know this information and share that with them. In episode two, we're going to be getting into a little bit later in the next episode, is going to be all about stigmas of STIs, what to do if you think you have one, what getting tested is like, going over different impacts of different STIs and STDs, as well as understanding what life can be like being diagnosed with an STD or an STI. I'm excited to have her on. I really am excited to bring this information to you. I think often it is talked about in a way that is, if you don't want an STI, don't have sex. And that's not necessarily true. We cover how you can get an STI from not having sex and many, many other things. So I am excited to bring this to you. If you have any questions, please feel free to call us at 385-449-1818. Give us a review online and iTunes or any place that you're listening to this podcast. Please feel free to share this with anybody that you know because this is a human issue. As well as let us know what questions you have, what things we didn't cover, what things we did cover that really supported you. I love hearing those stories. I love getting emails. Birdsandbeastpodcast@gmail.com is the place you can get me. So without further ado, let's get into the interview on this first one, and I'm excited to have you with us. Welcome back, Hive Mates. If this is your first one, we're so glad to have you here. This is Birds and Bees Podcast. Thanks for tuning in. All right, welcome to Birds and Bees Podcast. This is Braxton Dutson, and I'm here with Jenelle Marie Pierce. Welcome to the show, Jenelle.
Hello. Thank you so much for having me.
I'm so excited to have Jenelle on the show today because we are going to be talking about something that tends to be taboo for a lot of individuals and especially for parents because we don't know exactly, maybe we're not sure what to tell our kids about sexually transmitted diseases, sexually transmitted infections, and Jenelle is a pro on all this. She's dedicated, how much time have you been doing the STD project? And I mean, tell us a little bit about how you were getting into this education piece, Jenelle.
Yeah, how I became the STD whisperer, so to speak. That's friends and family, essentially, that's what they're calling me nowadays. And I'm, instead of being a famous person or viral online for something like reputable, I became infamous instead. So I've been doing this work for 7 years, and literally 7 years, actually, just in April was our 7-year anniversary. We launched alongside STD Awareness Month, which is every April, and that was back in 2012. My formal education, I have a BBA and an MBA in honors accountancy, and I was working as a healthcare analyst for Stryker, and then decided that there was something else and grander in my head that I wanted to do, and a little bit outside of the box and outside of the typical Monday through Friday corporate world that I was in, working 70 hours per week. And I was really successful, doing really good. But there was just more that I wanted to do, and I wanted to share my own personal experience. So I'm living with an STI. I have genital herpes, and I contracted it when I was 16 years old. Mm. And then I've also had other STIs, which, like, who admits all of that stuff out loud? I've had scabies and then HPV, but the majority of people have had that. We'll get into that, of course. But still, I thought that, you know, how I felt about myself did not reconcile with all of the stigma and the misconceptions that are associated with STIs and STDs and what folks believe about the certain kinds of people, quote unquote, who contract them. And so I wanted to at least create a way in which to allow people to share their stories, to open that conversation up, to make that narrative, to change the narrative and break the stigma a little bit and challenge our misconceptions and say, like, where does this originate from and why? And is this helpful? And is it healthy and accurate? And of course, no, it's not helpful. It's not healthy and it's not accurate. And so helping to empower people to make good decisions for themselves. And all of that is what the STD project is based upon.
Oh, right on. And so it's STD, the STD project dot, is it org or com?
.com. Yeah. So I'm the executive director of the STDproject.com. Mm-hmm. And then I'm the spokesperson for positivesingles.com. And then I'm also the founder of the Herpes Activist Network, which is called HANDS, and that stands for Herpes Activist Networking to Dismantle Stigma. So I wear a few hats. And
yeah.
I also do freelance writing, like I've written for Allure and Self and Cosmo, and I do a lot of press and media and things, answering questions just like we're doing today. So
wow.
Yeah, now after 7 years, I really am kind of an STI, STD expert. I mean, not kind of. I mean, truly, I know more about most STIs and STDs than a lot of clinicians because of the vast amount of research I've done.
Yeah. So if there are any questions that you have for Jenelle or even just about your situation, you can always go to the stdproject.com, and there they have so many references and up-to-date information about STIs and STDs. So if you're listening to this and you're like, we're not touching on this because there's a lot to cover, be sure to go to the stiproject.com and you're going to get your questions answered there. But what I hope to do for these next couple episodes is this first one, we're going to be talking more to parents and how to talk to your kids about this, as well as having, you know, these experiences as parents. And then in the next episode, we're going to be getting into more of adults, what getting tested would look like, and many of those questions that that people have asked me. So as we get into it right now, let's just start talking about what is an STD, STI? It kind of gets thrown back and forth. What might be some of the differences, Jenelle?
That's a super great question. So STD is the slightly older term. STI would be the more accurate for certain instances. So STI stands for sexually transmitted infections, and STD stands for sexually transmitted diseases. All STDs are preceded by an STI. So what that means is first you have to have an infection before you can have a disease when it comes to STI versus STD. So a lot of folks like STI a little bit better. They feel like it has a little less stigma associated with it because infection sounds a little bit less dire and scary than disease.
Oh, yeah.
But they're used interchangeably. And even before we used STD, we used VD, venereal disease. And that's not inaccurate either. It was just more narrowed, only talked about a few infections, whereas STI is 30 plus infections. According to the World Health Organization, there are 30 plus STIs, 30 plus infections that are sexually transmitted and commonly sexually transmitted. So most folks usually know of like a few of them: chlamydia, gonorrhea, HIV, syphilis, herpes, HPV. Folks have heard of all of those oftentimes if you ask them, but then the rest are like, whoa, I had no idea that there were so many. So anyhow, back to the STI versus STD. So you can use both. It's not necessarily wrong. A lot, you might start hearing like sexual health educators and some public health organizations are starting to use STI a little bit more often. Mm. And we do both. We use them interchangeably because we want to address the stigma head on. So STD carries a little bit more stigma associated with it. Plus, we want to make sure that we're reaching folks who are Googling and searching for information about STDs. So STD is still more well understood, and STI isn't as well known yet. So we want to just be able to provide information for everyone.
Gotcha. For most people, STI, STD might feel like splitting hairs and or not know about STI. So STD is kind of the catch-all to bring the information that people need to know back in. That makes sense. I was reading a little bit more. When some STDs can be treated, but can't be necessarily cured, is there a specificity towards like a viral versus a bacterial STI? What's the experience you know about bacterial and viral STDs?
Sure. So of those 30 plus infections, there are technically three different categories of STIs/STDs. And a lot of times I'll say it both at the same time, STIs, STDs, right? Because, mm-hmm. and I should have clarified too. So when all STIs all STDs are preceded by an STI, so you have the infection first, uh-huh. and it only is technically an STD if you have signs or symptoms, so noticeable signs or symptoms. Otherwise, it's all STIs. And then if you have noticeable signs or symptoms, then it becomes an STD. But if you're using either one, I mean, it's not wrong or whatever. I mean, we use them interchangeably right now, and that's totally fine. So anyhow, so there's three categories of STIs, STDs, and they are bacterial, viral, and parasitic. So all STIs can be either cured or managed. And it just depends on whether they are totally go away, or some go away on their own and can't necessarily be treated, or there's not necessarily medications for them, but you just have to wait the course, the duration for your body to your immune system. Hopefully, if it's in a healthier, pretty healthy position or state, then it will fight the infection on its own.
Oh.
Most viral infections are curable via antibiotics or prescription medication, but it's not over the counter stuff. So you have to get a test. You have to test positive for it and then receive a prescription. Otherwise, even if you don't notice any signs or symptoms, right? So you have an STI, you have an infection, you can transmit it to other people, but you will have no idea because you'll never know. And the problem with that is like, you may not know or feel anything or notice anything that's out of the ordinary for you, but it could be actually causing long-term damage that's irreparable if you don't get it tested and treated and identified. So bacterial infections are often curable, and then a lot of viral infections either cure on their own or they're lifelong. It's one or the other.
Mm-hmm.
There are some medications and things to remove or to reduce the duration, the severity, and or the risk of transmitting the viral infection to somebody else, but viral infections are not of that like curable category. And the parasitic infections, that's like a pubic lice or a scabies. Those are, or like a fungus, those like a yeast infection, those are also curable infections as well. So parasitic and bacterial curable infections, viral, they either go away on their own or they are manageable.
Oh, gotcha. Okay. So, wow. Tons of information. I love it. I love how much you know about this.
And I mean, it's there's like, so boom. Much to know, right?
There's a ton to know.
For sure.
And so being able to, as this episode is mostly geared towards parents wanting to talk to their kids about sex and understanding STIs, the first, I think of the joke that comes up where it's like, if you do have sex, you will get an STI and you will die. Or, you know, you will get pregnant and you will die. And as we try to bring more to the table about this, it's like, oh, crap. Well, yeah, you could contract an STD because that's the language that's being used. What are ways that STIs, STDs are passed? And maybe speaking from your experience, you say you contracted herpes at age 16. What do you wish you would have known about either getting the STD and also what would you like to know prior to as a teenager?
Yeah, those are such good questions because, yeah, I was 16 when I contracted herpes. And it was an awful experience. I was shamed by my peers, my medical practitioner at the time who diagnosed me. Mm. It was just really, really rough for a long time. And I'm 36 now, so that was 20 years ago. I can't even believe it's been two decades.
Wow.
But anyways, and it's really not a big deal. But at the time, immediately upon getting diagnosed, my mom brought me to my general practitioner. And I actually don't even remember this conversation or like saying these things. But on the ride home, I cried the entire time. And I said, no one will love me. I'm so dirty. No one will want me. I'm never going to be able to get married. I will never have kids. Like, I really thought life was over in terms of relationships and dating and partners and healthy relationships and a healthy sex life or anything. Going on. Any of that, I thought was totally now out of the question. And that, at the time, I was so shocked that I had contracted herpes, even though I was sexually active, and I'd had a couple of partners at that age, but I didn't know who transmitted it to me because I was too petrified to ask any of the couple of partners that I had had at that point in time. And And I didn't think, even then, I didn't think that those partners were the kind of people who contracted STIs and who would have herpes. And that is one of the biggest misnomers and misunderstandings, that we have these assumptions that only certain kinds of people, only certain ages, only super promiscuous people, whatever super promiscuous means to you. We just have these ideas that it's not going to happen to me. So we feel like it's not a relevant risk. And so I think for, like, if I could tell anybody, but also parents, when you're thinking about your kids, I mean, the idea of your kids having sex may, like, irk you a bit, and that's okay if it's uncomfortable and initially, and it's even okay, like, when you begin to have these conversations, I think, with your kids, you can even acknowledge that it's uncomfortable, because that shows that you're a real person. You're not always just this authoritative being in their life, and, like, things are silly and weird and awkward too. Like, you get that. And so you're acknowledging that and just acknowledging, like, your humanity. And I think even just, like, I think that helps to build intimacy amongst the conversation and make it feel a little more comfortable, because of course your kids, young adults, teens and things, and going into adulthood are going to be feeling a little uncomfortable about the conversation, because our culture tells us that we're not supposed to be having these conversations. We're not supposed to be having sex. Mm-hmm. It's all dirty. You're all, like you just said, you're going to die and or get pregnant, and none of those things are things you want. And so don't do it. And what we know, though, the thing is even having these conversations and talking to your young adults and children, adolescents into young adulthood, in all of that, adolescents to teenagers to young adults, it actually, by empowering them with information that's comprehensive, inclusive, and empathetic, we've found, studies have shown, that they're less likely to engage in sexual activity at a younger age, that the age that they decide to start engaging in activity is usually a year or two or later. Mm-hmm. And then when they're doing so, they're utilizing safer sex practices. So they're doing less risky behaviors because they feel empowered to advocate for themselves and to ask for the things that they want and to mitigate risk and reduce risk. And they know how. So totally. We know that, like, the majority of all people are going to become sexually active at some point. So it's like, why aren't we starting to have these conversations, asking them about them, these things, when they pop up slowly, presenting them in casual environments and things, and making them a conversation, just like we talk about the rest of our health, just like we talk about washing our hands when you leave the restroom. I mean, anyway, so, okay, so quick answer to this, you know, like, I'm giving you the longest.
No, I love it. I love this.
But baseline, if I could arm parents with not any, like, the simplest knowledge, the number one thing I would want parents to know is that the likelihood of their children and themselves contracting an STI is more likely than not. And what I mean by that is, so if we just look at the numbers, so right, instead of being alarmist, and I mean this in a just, like, let's be practical about it way, not, and I get that nobody wants an infection, like, I don't want a cold or the flu, but I know that it's likely, like, in my life, I'm probably going to get multiple colds and flus, and I already have in my life. So I realize this, and I do things to reduce my risk, but still it may end up happening. Mm-hmm. So if you look at, like, earlier on, I said there are 30 plus STIs, according to the World Health Organization. If we take one STI, HPV, 80% of all people contract HPV by the age of 50 at some point.
Wow.
Most don't know it, because HPV is a viral infection and it often clears on its own. But it can cause genital warts. Those are the low-risk strains. Or it can lead to cancer. That's rare, but those are the high-risk strains. So 80% of all people contract just this one STI. 80%.
Wow.
That's not my number. I didn't make that up. It's according to the American Sexual Health Association. Sorry, those are my dogs in the background.
You're good.
So according to the American Sexual Health Association, 80% of all people will contract HPV at some point. Most don't know it, because oftentimes it clears on its own, but there can be issues that coincide with the infection, depending on whether it's low risk or high risk. So that's one of the 30.
Wow.
There's tons of other very common infections. Herpes is one of them. Chlamydia, gonorrhea. I mean, there's tons of other trichomoniasis. There's tons of other very common infections. So it's very likely that this will happen. Again, it's not desirable, but this is why we want to talk about it. And we want to talk about it maybe not as often as we talk about the weather, because it's still our sexual health. And a lot of people are more modest about that when it comes to intimacy in their bodies. And that's totally cool. And I respect that. But we still want to talk about it. Like, we need to.
Yes, we need
so
to.
So that we can feel okay, you know? And so that when you're 16-year-old, and hopefully this doesn't happen, of course, like, I don't wish this upon people, but then when your 16-year-old contracts herpes like I did, they are not absolutely like in a tailspin mentally, health-wise, and just overall their outlook about it. I mean, again, it's not what anybody is like looking forward to. Nobody's signing up and saying, yeah, please get me some infections. But these things do happen. It's a part of our human experience. So talking about them as practical as we possibly can and helping our adolescents, teenagers, and young adults to make good decisions that they can feel good about with their bodies. So now I'll step off of my soapbox.
I'm so glad you went there, because knowing this, wow, 80%, 80% just off one versus 30. And knowing that this is a very big part.
Right?
Yeah, it blows my mind, especially the thought that it's not a relevant risk. Going back to what you're saying, where teenagers, even adults, are just like, hopefully I don't get this, but I'm not sleeping with this individual, or this person doesn't look like that. And we have this like you said, the relevant risk seems to be down when we don't understand that it comes to 80% of people with just one, and that there's multiple other STIs that you could contract and not even know about it. Man, it just blows my mind.
Part of it because we don't talk about it.
Yes, 100%. We don't talk about it. I'm wondering about, obviously we're calling sexually transmitted infections. And so how can we, I've understood there's other ways to contract an STI that does not necessarily involve sex.
Oh yeah, absolutely. So like some of the infections border along the line of like, and people will get up in arms about this, like, well, this is an STI because that's not how I contracted it. And it's because of the immense stigma associated with STIs that people don't want it, STDs, STIs, that people don't want it labeled that way. Mm-hmm. If it's young adults into adults who are contracting the infection, they contracted it sexually. It's very rarely that it's just a kind of benign, unless you're like a health worker and you work in like a daycare facility. So there's things that are skin to skin transmitted, HPV, molluscum, scabies, pubic lice. There's tons of infections that are transmitted almost as simple as just touch. Like they don't even necessarily need an entry point into the body, that they are really transmitted via touch. HPV actually does need an entry point into the body. So it's usually near, on or near places where there are small, tiny cuts or tears. That's why you see like people with warts on their fingers and toes, mm-hmm. around their nails and things like that, because it got into your system that way. But, things like, so molluscum, and that's a viral infection that has to just go away over time on its own. You have to wait for your body to fight it. Mm-hmm. Molluscum and scabies and pubic lice. And, those ones are really truly just a touching kind of situation. And those, so where I'm going with that is like, if you work in a daycare facility and you're constantly handling, someone at that skin to skin level, like facility workers holding babies and things and really mm-hmm. interacting with children at that level, you see scabies and molluscum in young children, and it's not sexually transmitted at that point in time. Herpes is another one that's a really good example. And HSV-1 and HSV-2 are both the herpes simplex viruses. And so like I have genital HSV-2, mm-hmm. but HSV-2 can also be oral. It can be above the waist. And HSV-1, which was traditionally kind of thought of as cold sores, that can be also below the waist and gets transmitted via oral sex. But a lot of children and family members pass on cold sores, HSV-1, via kissing from family members. So kissing young children, babies on the mouth, near the mouth, on the face, wherever, and then they end up having HSV-1. And then those same kids grow up into adolescents, young adults, teenagers, young adults, and start engaging in sexual activities. They're doing oral sex, mm-hmm. not realizing that oral, and a lot of folks do that with the thought process of like, well, I'm not going to get pregnant, mm-hmm. and it's safe. Oral sex is safe. There's nothing that can happen. And then they transmit HSV-1 to someone's genitals, and now someone has HSV-1 genitally, and so they have herpes. And mm-hmm. I mean, so we don't realize the connection of these things that can be kind of fairly benign. It carries less stigma because so many people get cold sores. Nobody really thinks much of it. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people get really bad cold sores. And like I've seen kids make fun of, adolescents make fun of one another or something if somebody's got a really bad like blister on their lip. Mm-hmm. And that's awful too. But what's sad about that is like that got transmitted from a family member. Somebody was kissing a child and they got it from an adult who already had it on their mouth. And mm-hmm. the adult didn't realize that that was transmittable that way.
Yeah.
So each infection, and we won't delve into like the details because that would get boring and it's overwhelming about how each individual infection is transmitted. But to like, there is so much, you know, and a lot of people ask me like, well, what about this? What about that? I'm like, if I, to sum it up and to make sense of it, there are certain things that are transmitted via skin-to-skin contact. Mm-hmm. There are certain things that are transmitted via skin-to-skin contact, but they need an entry point into the system. So it's not just a simple touch. There are things that are transmitted via body fluids, either blood. Some things are only transmitted via blood, and then other things are transmitted via saliva, genital secretion. So essentially, there's kind of like 3 to 4 categories. The skin-to-skin transmission can be broken down in two ways because not everything is just like, oh, I'm going to touch you and now I have this infection. It's not that easily transmitted. Otherwise, everyone I know would have herpes. Like,
yes.
From all of my friends and family, this would be hugging stuff. And that's just not the case. But anyways, skin-to-skin transmission or bodily fluids, and either there's different kinds of fluids that transmit different kinds of infections, or breast milk is another one in the fluids category. But anyways, there's so much to know because, like I said, there's 30 plus infections, and you don't have to be an expert on them. You just have to know, back to what you were just saying, Braxton, the relevant risk, that it's quite relevant. As soon as you become sexually active, all activities contain some level of risk. That doesn't mean that's bad. There's reward involved in all activities. So like there's literal risk in everything we do. If we even stayed in our house and never left our house, there's still risk involved in that, actually, like never seeing the sunlight and never seeing people. And you know what I mean? So there's actually risk in literally every choice that we make, but there's usually an equal and opposite reward. So like when I leave my house to go teach, I teach exercise classes at, or group fitness classes at the YMCA. When I leave my house to go teach classes, I get in my car, I put my seatbelt on, I use my blinker before I turn, you know, because I know that there's a risk of a car accident, somebody pulling out in front of me, an animal coming out into the road. I mean, I realize that there's some risk involved. So I'm aware, I'm doing things to reduce that risk as much as I possibly can. But at the end of the day, do people still get in car accidents? Sure. But are we never going to leave our house? Am I never going to go teach a group fitness class? Definitely not. And I feel like the same applies with sexual health and safer sex. And when we're talking about risk, and that's kind of how we can bring it back down to a level that's like not so crazy. If we're talking to young adults, even if we're talking to adolescents and they're starting to ask, you know, like the preteens and things, if they're starting to ask like what STIs are, they hear people making jokes or whatever. And you can say like, well, you know, adults have sex and people and engage in sexual activities. And there's some things that happen. Sometimes some bad things happen, just like sometimes you catch a cold. Sometimes we go to the movies and if you didn't wash your hands all the way, you know, and it's not necessarily like there's always a bad consequence of not being as safe as possible, because you can even wash your hands and still catch a cold.
I mean,
but you do some things to make it a little less scary, a little less risky. And there's just a way to, I think you can slowly start talking about it in a simple form. You can relate it to everyday things, because sex and healthy sex lives and intimacy, physical intimacy with people and partners, is a part of our everyday lives. So if we don't acknowledge that and we shy away from it or if we're afraid of it, we're just not helping our young ones to make good decisions. Like, it's scary. Like, I think to me, all of these folks wandering out in the world, just like I did, you know, I was absolutely like petrified and depressed and, you know, whatever. And so that's what I want to equip people to not have to feel like, essentially.
Oh, definitely. And so the, going back to your analogy of riding in the car, putting on your seatbelt doesn't necessarily, it's not a guarantee that you're not going to get hurt, injured, pass away. However, you know, there's not that risk that's there. And just similar to using protection in a way of maybe talking to your partner, using condoms, talking to your teens or your kids about these different practices that they can do to help protect themselves, but also understanding and letting them know like, hey, this is not a, a fail-safe. Use a condom. There are still many other ways and many STD or STIs that you could contract. And that does not all of a sudden, well, I use condoms, so I don't need to get tested, or I'm using condoms because that's the number one that I'm thinking of that that I recommend. Do you have other ways that people can help protect themselves, or that we can help arm our teens to be protected, but then also knowledgeable about, hey, this is the risk I'm participating in?
Yeah, I think that's a really great point, because especially when you get into older teens and young adults, you get that like, oh, well, I always use a condom, you know? And I'm like, well, we shouldn't use absolutes when we're talking about our sex lives, because that probably is unlikely. Uh-huh. And then secondarily, are you using a condom every time you are doing like manual sex? So hand jobs and things? Like, no, probably not. Are you using a condom every time you're engaging in oral sex, like blowjobs and going down on someone? Like, no, probably not doing that either. And, and yes, there's like a hierarchy in terms of risk. So manual sex, like touching types of sexual activity, that is not including mouths or genitals, is going to be the most safe, but there's still risk involved. Like I said, because there's skin to skin transmitted infections. Then oral sex is next. And so oral sex is less safe than manual, but more safe than penetrative sex. Mm-hmm. And then penetrative sex also has two steps. Like vaginal penetration is safer, than anal penetration. And then sometimes it depends on which body parts are getting involved. I mean, there's a whole lot to consider. And it's like, nope, there, unfortunately, there's risk in everything. And that's okay if you're doing your very best and you think you're doing well, or you think you're like doing as much as you can. And then you didn't even realize that there was more you could do. And so to answer that question more succinctly, yeah, there's things like you could use gloves or dams, or you could cut a condom up and turn it into a barrier and in front of the genitals, especially if it's like, on female genitalia, or I should say like an vulva. Mm-hmm. And anyways, there's absolutely different ways to include barriers. Just the conversation alone, though, talking to partners about like, hey, have you ever been tested, or do you use condoms, or do you have any other partners? And what were you tested for if you were tested? Because most people will be like, oh yeah, I was tested for everything and I'm clean. Well, you can't be tested for everything. There's no such way. And because normally people are tested for like when you get an STI panel, even if you say like, I want to be tested for all the things, I want the full panel, usually you're only being tested for like 4 to 5 infections. And like I said, there's 30 plus out there. So you can get tested for as many as possible. And that's awesome. High five. Cool. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't mean you're tested for all the things. And then we don't use the word clean, because hygiene has very little, if anything at all, to do with STI transmission. Mm-hmm. You know, so then some of these are kind of yellow flags to, you know, like, oh, okay, well, the person isn't like 100% fully aware of all the things and all the elements that are involved. And so there's conversations, but it's also a growing thing. Like, you don't have to know it all initially, and you can realize like, oh, I engaged in that activity and it was more risky than I realized. And now I'm a little concerned about it, or it made me feel afterward not so great. And this is the same with all consent and all consensual activities, of like any activity you're doing. Like, you can decide later that you don't necessarily want to do that again, or you want to do it in a different way. And that's okay. There's nothing wrong with the way that you already did it. It's just like, now you've learned something, you've grown from it. Cool. Now decide what you want to do and how you want to engage. Another thing too, that I think is that most people don't talk about, or I don't hear talked about as often, is lube. Like, lube doesn't get encouraged and talked about. Oh, it's always condoms and condoms that are already pre-lubricated, and everybody's lubrication is different. Mm-hmm. And depending on what kind of sex you're engaging in, especially if it's anal sex, our anus does not naturally lubricate on its own. So we want extra lube when we're engaging in any kind of anal play. But even if you're not engaging in anal play, and lube is a barrier, so it adds a small film, and it also reduces the amount of small cuts and tears that can happen. Mm-hmm. And somebody might be like, well, I don't, you know, when I'm engaging in sex, there's no cuts or tears. Like, it doesn't hurt. It feels good. Like, it's fine. But you don't feel those. There's tiny little micro tears and things that you totally don't feel and don't even notice, because our bodies are very resilient, and you totally just might not have a clue that that's happening. Mm-hmm. But if you're adding the lube, then that's reducing the likelihood. And those small, tiny cuts and tears are where infections enter the body. So some infections need an entry point. They can't just touch you and now you're infected. They actually need a place to get into the system. And those little cuts and tears allow for that to happen. So things like lube, extra barriers, or different kinds of barriers for different kinds of activity. Discussion, though, I think communication is the very first thing that has to happen, or doesn't necessarily, I hate to say have to happen, because it's not up to me to decide what's good for anybody else in their bodies. But communication helps empower people to make good decisions. And so you can remove your consent at any point in time if you need to. You can move forward and feel good. Like, the best thing, and I think kind of like, I heard another educator talk about this the other day. They were saying that it's not about people having to say no and put all these, like, here are all my boundaries up and my barriers of, like, what has to happen in order to have sex. It's about being able to enjoy the activity and not have any, and not have immense guilt or fear, and just to truly be able to engage and to reap the rewards of a healthy sexual encounter, as opposed to, like, if you're not thinking of along those lines of safer sex practices, then you engage in the encounter and you may enjoy it for a short moment, like at the time while it's happening. But then you're like the, oh crap for like weeks later. And you can't get tested right away. Like, you could engage in an activity and you can't run out the next day and get tested and find out if you contracted anything. It takes weeks and sometimes months for these infections to actually become present on a test, if you can be tested for them at all. So it's like, you know, so then you're stuck with this like dread because there wasn't that like due diligence put forth initially. Right. So, and I don't mean that to shame anyone. Like if some, you know, if you did an activity and you're like, shoot, that's okay. This happens. You know, this is again, part of the human experience, like whatever, but now you know, like how that felt. And so here are the tons of different ways in which you can go forward and try and reduce your risk as much as possible. But there's going to be some risk, you know, there's no such thing as safe sex. There's just safer sex.
Yeah. When it comes to the way that you would have liked your parents, your doctor, other people to have responded to you when getting a positive test for herpes, how, so say a parent has a teenager that comes to them and says, I have an STD or I something's going on. You go get tested. You find out, hey, this is an STI. This is an STD. So you find out your child has been diagnosed. How and what might be some best responses to remain from shaming them, as well as giving them the support they need? And what would you have liked to experience versus what your experience was?
My mom was great in that she was like, it will be okay. And this isn't the end. And she didn't have a whole lot of information about like numbers, how likely it is, how common it is, how not alone I was, essentially. But she did try and encourage me to not go down that path of like, this is all the end of the world and it's at the end of all my relationship and potential and things. So she didn't believe it, and she didn't want me to believe it. So she did good that way. The doctor at the time, walked back into the room after taking a culture of the outbreak that I was having. I was having my very first outbreak, and he walked back in and he said, this is herpes, and this is genital herpes, and it's the worst case of herpes I've ever seen.
Ooh.
Here's a prescription for Valtrex. And then he left the room. Oh my gosh, it was so bad. Oh. It was so bad. And so not only am I this like dirty, tainted, trashy, you know, slutty whore, whatever it is, all these words that are thrown at people with STIs. Now I'm the dirtiest and the trashiest because I have the worst case. This doctor, the person who you think is going to be empathetic, understanding, you know, whatever, have all this information and have seen this kind of thing before, tells you it's the worst. And I'm like, it was just a horrible experience.
Oh,
and not
shoot.
Only that, what was also worse is that he didn't provide me with anything, any baseline information. Like, this is super common. There are 65 million people in the US or more, according to the CDC, who have genital herpes. And that's, it's long-term, so it's forever. And that's, and plus there's like, what's the number of new herpes infections per year? I want to say 700,000, but I may be wrong. I'd have to look that up. Anyways, there's tons of people contracting it all the time. I mean, again, it's not like it's ideal, and it's not like it's what anybody ever wants for their future, for their health, for their physical situation, but these things happen and it's not that big of a deal and it'll be fine and whatever. Later on, I had gone to a Planned Parenthood and they were like, oh, I can't, you know, had had a couple of nurses be like, everybody comes in with herpes. You don't even understand. Like, almost every single person we see has herpes. Like, it's no big deal. And the doctor's like, I have herpes. I mean, people were just very, very real about it and just practical and not overly emotional. And I think that's the best thing you could probably do is be as practical. The simplest advice I could give is to provide a couple of resources to try your best not to be overly emotional along with your child and to be as nonplussed about it as possible. Just practical, and direct, and then provide some resources. Because the one thing I can say about my mom's perspective is that it was my mom. And in my head, I thought, you don't know what it's like. And mm-hmm. you don't get it, you know, like you're how much older than I am and whatever. So in some ways you discount your parents, even if they're providing you with positive feedback, you're going to discount some of what they say. So providing some additional resources, links, whatever resources you really like. It doesn't have to be my own. It can be the Birds and the Bees podcast. It can be anything. Scarlatine's really good. I mean, there's tons of really good websites out there that are thoughtful, but finding something that you feel comfortable with and good about. Our Bodies Ourselves is a great book. SEX is a really good book by Heather Carino, who does scarlatine. So you'd probably have to like her kind of standpoint and approach as well to want to suggest that. But anyways, the whole point is just a few resources and to point your child in the right direction and then say it is going to be okay and it's all right. And then also open the door. And I think this is for any conversation, right? Like you don't have to sit down and have this Birds and the Bees conversation necessarily all at one time. It can be slowly in steps as it evolves, and it doesn't have to be face to face. It can be like riding in the car mm-hmm. after you see something on a movie or you hear it somewhere offhandedly, like a random advertisement, whatever. It can all be this nice process. And then it can be like, you know, I know that this is tough right now. And so take a little bit and think about it. And if you want to talk about it again, let's do that. Yeah. And then if you see them kind of like in a place, then you can ask like, what's going on? Is this bothering you? Do you want to talk about it? You know, and of course they can still choose to say like, no, they don't. And then you have to respect that because that also is demonstrating boundaries and consent and whatever by respecting their choice to not necessarily conversate, but I think continuing Definitely. To open up the door, letting them know that you are a safe space is mm-hmm. so key.
Oh, that's wonderful. And I completely agree with you when it comes to maintain and understand your experience is going to be probably reactive. Keep the reaction back, show support to your child, get your own supports where you can go talk to someone where you can have your experience and your emotional, whatever it may be as a parent. But if you can maintain that connection with your child, you're going to get them support they need, let them know that this isn't the end of their life, and you're going to work through this with them. And I think that that's one of the best ways that you can approach anything as a parent. So I love what you're saying there.
I think that's great. And you said something that also triggered me. I think it's important to make a point to resist the urge not to try and figure out the details. Like, well, what happened? And did you use a condom? And who is this person? And how much sex did you have? You know, like, or what kind of sex or any sort of details, because really how it happened at that point, you know, like it can be a conversation of like, do you feel like, you know, you did as much as you possibly could to reduce it. And I mean, there can be a discussion about risk, but I think especially right after an initial diagnosis, that is definitely not the time because mm-hmm. your young adult, your child could have done everything right, quote unquote, and still contracted something. So at that point, it's like, then you're showing them exactly how society is going to view this newfound news. It's like, they're going to assume that something went wrong, that they did something bad. It was a result of their bad behavior, a consequence. Uh-huh. When really sometimes there's nothing you can do about it. It's not necessarily a consequence of any kind of reaction or behavior that's bad, good, or otherwise. You know, these things just sometimes happen as much as you try and avoid them. So I think that kind of mindset as much as possible. And I that would be hard for me too, because I'm a person who like wants to be a problem solver. So let's figure this out so that this never happens again. And so that I can protect you. And of course, like you want to protect your children. You want to make sure you want to. And so now you almost feel like, shoot, I didn't. And now my child's in this situation. So how do I help them avoid this in the future? But I think resisting that urge to go into that line of thinking at that point in time, and maybe entirely, you know, I can't say, some of that has to happen organically. And if you mm-hmm. start talking about it and like, there's still some potential for education and for growth and things there with a diagnosis, but I think you got to tread on very, very careful ground at that point in time.
100%. Well, thank you so much, Jenelle. This has been very insightful, especially for parents. It's been insightful for me on a lot of these stats. It's amazing. So I appreciate you being on the show. We are going to get into the next episode, which will air in the following episode. And we're going to be talking more to adults, to individuals, whether you're having casual sex, whether you're in a committed relationship, and how you can have these conversations about STIs, STDs, and what more information you need to know. So I'm excited to get into the next episode, and we'll see you in the next week. Wasn't that a great interview? Man, I love interviews like this. Remember, we love when you send these episodes to your friends and family. There's a good chance you know someone who could use some extra support or the information that was just discussed in this last episode. Send them a link, tell them about it. You can send it through iTunes, send them the birdsandbeespodcast.com link, any way that best will get them the information, and it can help a lot to those that you love. We really appreciate you sharing this. Please consider leaving us a review on iTunes. That helps us immensely with getting this content out. And know that I love you. Love the fact that you guys are helping me out with my goal and sharing this information with the entire world and changing the way that we talk about sexual health and changing the interactions we have with our kids as well as our partners. If you have any questions or you want to join the conversation, send me a call or give me a text at 385-449-1818. Send me an email, birdsandbeespodcast@gmail.com. All this is going to be great. Love to hear from you hive mates. And I look forward to talking with you guys in the next episode. So until then, keep the sexual health buzz alive, and I'll see you in the next episode.